we're finding integrals of trig functions, we're going to be looking for u substitutions. But sometimes it's tricky to figure out what the right u substitution should be. So today we're going to look at patterns in some of the ways that we could determine the u substitution that we need for various kinds of trig integrals. For this integral, we have cosine cubed of x sine to the 10th of x dx. Our choices seem to be to let u equal sine of x or u equal cosine of x. Let's think about which one of these will make more sense. If we let u equal sine of x, then du would be cosine of x dx. Alternately, if we let u equal cosine of x, then du would be negative sine of x dx. So the question that we want to pose, and this is usually what you want to think about with trig integrals, is what trig function would you like to set aside to use as your du? If we look at our integral here, if we set aside a sine to use as our du, then we would be looking at cosine cubed of x times sine to the 9th of x times sine of x dx. If we wanted to use this as a negative du, then we would be left with sine to an odd power. What we're going to see in a moment is when sine is to an odd power and left over, it's very difficult to convert it into cosines so that we could use the substitution u equals cosine. If instead what we did was we used our cosine for our du, and we wrote our function as cosine squared, taking away one of those cosines, sine to the 10th of x times cosine of x dx, then we have cosine of x dx is going to be our du. Sine to the 10th of x, remember we're using the substitution u equals sine of x in this case, so this is u to the 10th. And now we're left with a cosine squared. And now, if we want to convert everything to u's, we have a problem, because we don't know how to convert cosine of x to u. But thankfully, here is where the trick comes in. We do know something about the relationship between sine and cosine. In particular, we know the Pythagorean identity, sine squared of x plus cosine squared of x equals 1. This allows us to rewrite cosine squared in terms of sine squared. So we can say cosine squared of x is equal to 1 minus sine squared. So using that to rewrite our integral, we get the new integral, 1 minus sine squared times sine to the 10th of x times cosine of x dx. This allows us to make the substitution 1 minus sine squared becomes 1 minus u squared, sine to the 10th becomes u to the 10th, and cosine of x dx becomes du. Rewriting this in terms of u, we get the integral of 1 minus u squared, u to the 10th, du. Now we can distribute to get u to the 10th minus u to the 12th, du. And that's something that we know how to integrate. We get u to the 11th over 11 minus u to the 13th over 13 plus c, which converting back to x's gives us, remember we used u equals sine of x to the 11th over 11 minus sine of x to the 13th over 13 plus c. So notice that what we did here was say that if our beginning integral had an odd power of cosine in it, then we could take one of those cosines and move it to the n to be used as our du. And then the remaining cosines would be to an even power. All of those cosines will be able to be converted to sines using this Pythagorean identity. Now let's look at sine to the 5th of x cosine squared of x dx. Notice that this time the power of cosine is even. So if we steal one of those cosines to be du, we would just be left with a single cosine. This would make it more difficult to use the Pythagorean identity to turn that into sine. But instead, if we look at sine, the power of sine is now odd. So if we steal a sine to use that as our du, now we have an even power of sines remaining. So if we wanted to have du equals sine of x dx, that means we're trying to make the substitution u equals cosine of x. Well, here's cosine squared, so that will be a u squared. But now we have a sine to the fourth of x left. So what we're going to do is we're going to write sine to the fourth of x is equal to sine squared of x squared. Now we know from the Pythagorean identity that sine squared is 1 minus cosine squared. Putting that all together, we're going to have a new integral of 1 minus cosine squared, the whole thing squared, times cosine squared of x times sine of x dx. So now our sine of x dx at the end, we save that to be du. Cosine squared is u squared. And 1 minus cosine squared of x squared becomes 1 minus u squared squared. So our new integral looks like 1 minus u squared squared times u squared times du. Now this might look like it would be a difficult integral to compute, but actually, if we just FOIL out and distribute, it's not too bad. First we FOIL out, we get 1 minus 2u squared plus u to the fourth times u squared du. Now we're going to distribute, and we're going to get the integral of u squared minus 2u to the fourth plus u to the sixth du. This gives us u cubed over 3 minus 2u to the fifth over 5 plus u to the seventh over 7 plus c. Converting back to x's, we recall that we use the substitution u equals cosine of x. So we get cosine cubed of x over 3 minus 2 fifths cosine to the fifth of x plus 1 seventh cosine to the seventh of x plus c. So note here that when sine has an odd power and cosine has an even power, we can just use the opposite substitution, let u equal cosine of x, and then the same technique that we used when cosine had an odd power will work with the sine and cosine reversed. The only thing you have to be careful of here, and we forgot to do this, is when you take the derivative of cosine, you actually get a negative sign. And so a negative sign means that when you make the substitution, instead of substituting sine of x dx for du, you're going to get a negative du. So once you've made that substitution, your entire integral is going to be negative. This is important to point out because the same thing will be true later in this lesson when we talk about secants and tangents. When you're talking about doing a substitution for a co-function, like cosine instead of sine, secant instead of cosecant, tangent instead of cotangent, the same techniques are going to work, except that you're going to have to remember that negative sign when you take the derivative. Now let's look at tangent to the fourth of x, secant to the fourth of x dx. Let's recall that the derivative of tangent of x is equal to secant squared of x, and the derivative of secant of x is equal to secant of x tangent of x. So just like sine and cosine, it makes sense to consider integrals of just these two functions. This time, the question becomes, do we want to save a secant squared to be our du, or do we want to save a secant of x tangent of x to be our du? Remember that if we want to use Pythagorean identities, which work for tangents and secants just as well as sines and cosines, we want to have an even power of whatever function we take for the du left. So if we look at this function, tangent to the fourth of x, secant to the fourth of x,
If we take a secant squared away to be du, we'll have a secant squared left, which we can convert to tangent squared. If we instead took a secant tangent, we'd be left with an odd tangent and an odd secant. So let's not do that. Let's choose the substitution u equals tangent of x, so that we're working with du equals secant squared of x dx. So what we want to do is rewrite our integral, saving a secant squared at the end to be our du. Since we're writing things in terms of u, tangent to the fourth is going to become u to the fourth. And now we just have to figure out what to do with secant squared. So as I mentioned, we can use the Pythagorean identity. This time, when we're writing the Pythagorean identity in terms of tangents and secants, you have to remember the signs. Just in case you forget, you can always derive it. If you know that sine squared of x plus cosine squared of x is equal to 1, then if you just divide everything through by cosine squared, you'll get that sine squared over cosine squared will be tangent squared of x plus cosine squared over cosine squared is 1 equals 1 over cosine squared, which is secant squared of x. So we can replace secant squared with tangent squared plus 1. So we will rewrite our integral as tangent to the fourth of x times tangent squared plus 1 times secant squared of x dx. Now we'll save our secant squared of x dx as du. Tangent squared of x plus 1 becomes u squared plus 1, and tangent to the fourth of x becomes u to the fourth. So our new integral is u to the fourth times u squared plus 1 times du. Distributing gives us u to the sixth plus u to the fourth du. So integrating gives us u to the seventh over 7 plus u to the fifth over 5 plus c. And then we convert back to x's to get tangent to the 7th of x over 7 plus tangent to the 5th of x over 5 plus c. Now let's look at tangent cubed of x, secant cubed of x. Remember that again we want to decide, do we want du to be secant squared of x dx, or do we want du to be secant of x, tangent of x, dx. This time, both tangent and secant have odd powers. If we were to pick secant squared as our du, we would split secant cubed into secant of x times secant squared. We would be using the secant squared of x for the du, and we'd have just a single secant left over, which seems like a bad idea. So this time, since the power of secant is odd, and the power of tangent is also odd, let's try du equals secant of x tangent of x dx. That means that u will be secant of x. That means that the secants are good, and we just need to convert all the tangents into secants, other than whatever we need to save for our du. So let's pull out the du first. So taking one secant and one tangent, we'll have tangent squared of x, secant squared of x, times secant of x, tangent of x, dx. So here will be our du. Secant squared will become u squared. And we're left with just the tangent squared to figure out how to turn that into secants. And we know how to do that using the Pythagorean identity. So note that this worked out so well because the power of tangent was odd and positive. Alright, so let's replace tangent squared with what it should be from the Pythagorean identity. Remember that we had tangent squared plus 1 is equal to secant squared of x. So solving for tangent squared, we'll get tangent squared of x is equal to secant squared of x minus 1. So we get secant squared of x minus 1 times secant squared of x times secant of x tangent of x dx. So we have our du at the end. Secant squared becomes u squared, and secant squared minus 1 becomes u squared minus 1. Making our substitution, we get the integral of u squared minus 1 times u squared du. Distributing, we get u to the 4th minus u squared du, which is, after we integrate, u to the 5th over 5 minus u cubed over 3 plus c, which, converting back to x's, gives... Remember, we used u equals secant, so secant
to the fifth of x over 5 minus secant cubed of x over 3 plus c. So when the power of tangent is odd and positive, we want to let u equal secant and save a secant tangent at the end. Compare that to when the power of secant is even and positive, then we want to take u equal tangent and save a secant squared at the end for our du. Now let's look at one more example. What if tangent is even and secant is odd? The u equals secant derivative worked well when tangent was odd, and the u equals tangent technique worked well when secant was even, but in this case we don't have either one. So we have a couple of options. One option is to convert everything to secants and use the reduction formulas. The other option is to convert everything to sines and cosines. This will work for any trig integral you're given, even if it's not one of the special ones we've talked about. Although when you convert to sines and cosines, you're not guaranteed to get an integral that you'll know how to actually integrate once you've done the u substitution.